I'm Byron York.
I'm Michael Barone.
And we have to talk about Paris and 2016. I think one thing concerning the Republican race that was interesting almost immediately after Paris, a lot of wise voices in the Republican Party said, well, this means voters will immediately apply a commander-in-chief test to all of the candidates, and Ben Carson and Donald Trump won't pass. Well, I think what we've seen the early results are is Ben Carson didn't pass. But Donald Trump is doing just fine, maybe even stronger, actually, because of this, because of some of the things he has said about ISIS. The day before the attack, he said he would bomb the blank out of ISIS, and he said similar things in the past. So it seems to me, as far as Republican primary voters are concerned, the man at the top of the of the race, Trump, is not being affected by this.
I'd add a note of caution to that, Byron. I think this hasn't necessarily sunk in. I think that it does obviously show that the problem with terrorism is more immediate, more threatening, can strike in more places than people were thinking about prior to the Paris attacks. And, you know, we'll see how Trump and others hold up there. I mean, we've been seeing an inching up in the polls, and I don't want to overstate it, but I think it's true in various states and nationally, of Marco Rubio.
Right.
Also, to some extent, of Ted Cruz, but a little more Rubio. You've got some national poll, I think one national poll and some state polls, where Rubio is challenging Trump and or Carson and so forth for the lead. And, you know, he's been very crisp in his articulation of foreign policy. He at least gives the impression of being very well informed and of having strong, well thought out views. And I think it could be a plus for him. I think we'll have to see how this rolls out. I wouldn't take the polls that are just taken on the weekend. Maybe people were out on Saturday night.
Could have been. So Jeb, by the way, Jeb Bush goes to the Citadel, gives a strong speech on national defense. Unclear how that will help him. One thing I've noticed in the Rubio-Cruz dynamic is that we're seeing more attacks, one or the other. And I believe our colleague David Drucker pointed this out, the Rubio attack on Cruz over the NSA and over surveillance and over this USA Freedom Act. The Rubio attack, I believe David pointed out, was the first time Rubio was throwing the first punch. Do you sense any nervousness in the Rubio crowd, even though they're doing well, any nervousness about Cruz?
Well, I think they see Cruz as a clear rival for the nomination. That's very plausible, given the polling. If you operate on the assumption, as an optimistic person working for any other campaign would, that somehow Trump is going to and Carson will fade and you'll be competitive for the lead. I think they see him as an obvious thing. And, you know, when we go back to those votes on the NSA, remember, those were being taken at a time with the Edward Snowden revelations. You had Rand Paul running, you know, very strong, probably 20% or so on Republican primaries. And you had a significant block of Republican primary voters that basically seemed to be taking the view, the heck with all these foreigners, let's stop interfering in that. Mm-hmm. When ISIS started beheading Americans and beheading Christians, I think that block changed their attitude towards something like, we need to kill all these people.
Yes. Now let's talk a little bit about the Democrats. You had a great column which basically said, after the Paris atrocity, Barack Obama got really angry at Americans.
Well, I think that's the conclusion you have to come to if you've been watching or reading the transcript of his press conference in Italia, Turkey on Monday. He recited, well, we've had a little setbacks here. We've had setback in Paris, but our slow process was to degrade and ultimately destroy Islamic State.
Ultimately
is the word that
who knows?
That a lot of Americans have trouble with. And then he really gets tough at the end, where he's talking about Americans who counsel a different strategy. He uses disparaging language about them. He uses disparaging, he uses shameful about people that don't want to admit Syrian refugees way. It's shameful. It's un-American.
Betrayal of our values.
He talks about we don't want a religious test. In fact, our asylum law, passed long ago, enforced by presidents of both parties, provides a religious test in the form of saying we give a preference to people who are victims of religious persecution. Mm-hmm. There certainly has been religious persecution of Christians, of Yazidis, of Baha'i, and other groups in Syria and the Middle East.
We saw a poll come out in which Bloomberg asked about the various positions on refugees. Do you support the president's position, which is to admit 10,000 without a religious screen? Would you support not admitting any Syrian refugees, or would you support admitting only Syrian Christian refugees? The bottom line is 28% supported the president. The rest of them went for something else. I think maybe 8% were undecided. So the president is in a minority here.
And he's assailing the majority as being un-American and un-Christian, which is actually, when you think about it, not a good way to persuade people to change their minds. What you might do if you really felt that we have screening policies that will screen out bad people for things is to explain those policies. Mm-hmm. Not immediately obvious to most Americans that we have such policies, and it's entirely plausible that we don't. So if you take that position, you should be explaining to people. Insulting them first and accusing them of being un-American is not a good way to win them over.
And it's not working with Democrats on the Hill, because the House has passed, I believe, with 289 votes, which includes 47 Democrats, this Republican bill for a pause in the acceptance
that
of Syrian
refugees. 289 is a veto-proof majority.
That will send a message. Now, however, it's got to get to the Senate. I have the sense that Democrats and Republicans there might change the bill in such a way. Harry Reid is saying, don't worry, it ain't ever going to get out. But a veto-proof majority in the Senate tells you that the president
had Senator Chuck Schumer indicate the
He
came out for a pause in immigration. I think he may have been hearing from people in a part of his constituency called New York City.
I think he could be.
That has been and always will be a terrorist target as long as there are terrorists.
Absolutely.
And I think that asking a lot of Democrats to walk the plank on a 28% issue is a tough one. Maggie Hassan, the governor of New Hampshire, Democrat, who's running for the Senate against Republican Kelly Ayotte, she said, we don't want any of these refugees in New Hampshire. Now, maybe her electoral situation was totally off her mind. I think she had some mind on it.
That's
You know, a lot of Democrats are going to say, nice for you, Mr. President, to take a 28% position and give yourself a profile of courage of being the only one that's pro-American on this. You don't have to run for re-election again.
That's
we
right.
do.
And 47 members of the House voted with Democratic members voted with Republicans. And that is it for us. We hope to see you next time.